Let's close our eyes for prayer. Our great God in heaven, we thank you for your touch in our lives. Thank you because of what you are doing already. Thank you for the impact of the studies we're having in the book of Joshua. Our prayer is, Lord, you make out of every brother here, every sister here, a real leader like the model and the example of Joshua in Jesus' name. Like you walked with him. We're praying that you'll walk with all of your children. As you exalted him, magnified him, and confirmed your word in his mouth. So we're praying that you'll do for every brother, every sister here in Jesus' name. We're praying that the impact of these studies will be felt in our personal lives, in our families, as well as in all our districts in Jesus' name. Use us, Lord, as mighty instruments in your hand. Glorify yourself in the life and in the ministry of every one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Today we come to the 8th study in the book of Joshua. We're looking at chapter 3 today. And in this chapter 3, we find a great miracle. And it is the miracle of passing through the impassable. River Jordan at this time overflowed its bank. And naturally, it will be very difficult for them or for any group of people to pass through at this time. Human wisdom would have suggested to them they should wait until the river will go down. But they wouldn't wait because they were following the directives and the direction of the Lord. Last week, we saw the condition that the Lord wanted them to fulfill if they will have a great miracle or the wonder that he wanted to perform in their midst. Look at chapter 3, verse 5. And Joshua said unto the people, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. Before we get into the study proper tonight, let me tell you three things. Number one, we find as we look at what we're looking at today, condition for God's wonders. Condition for God's wonders. Although Joshua was referring in particular to the wonder that we find in chapter 3 and also in chapter 4, the dividing of Jordan. But we know that what is said also will go for any other wonder, any other supernatural thing the Lord wants to do in our lives. Condition for God's wonders. Sanctify yourselves. Self-tapass yourself. Cleanse yourself from all the filthiness of the flesh and of the spirit, because you want to prepare and be in readiness for the wonders, the miracles, and the exploits that the Lord wants to do among you. Number two, the catalog of God's wonders. As you look at the book of Joshua, you'll find it's not just one miracle. You find miracle after miracle. Because these children of Israel, it was a new generation. They continued in faith, they continued in obedience, and God continued walking with them. His wonders and his miracles. The first thing gives us a condition. The second thing gives us the catalog. And then, as you look through the book of Joshua itself, you see the consummation of God's wonders. In fact, Joshua makes a summary for us. If you open your book to Joshua chapter 23, in verse 3, verse 9, and verse 14, here Joshua looked back at all the things that happened from the beginning of his ministry with them until the very end. He said, you have seen all that the Lord your God has done. Then he continues to say, for the Lord has driven out from before you great nations and strong. At the time where we are now, they were just looking forward. And they were just about to cross River Jordan. It appeared no miracle had taken place yet. But he was telling them, he was very sure miracles are going to take place if they will fulfill the condition. I'm praying that before we finish the book of Joshua, you yourself, you'll be able to look back in your own life, in your own family, in your ministry. You will know that wonders are not just a few and rare farm between your life. It will be a catalog of God's wonders in Jesus' name. And then the consummation, as he told them, you have seen how the Lord has driven out from before you great nations and strong. But as for you, no man has been able to stand before you unto this day. And then it says in verse 14, behold, not one seed has failed of all the good things which the Lord your God spake concerning you, all are come to pass unto you, all shall come to pass, and not one seed has failed thereof. In fact, the book of Joshua is a very great challenge, because they are the great beginning and they are the glorious ending. We're looking at our study today as we look at the exploit, the supernatural, the breakthrough, the miracle of passing through the impossible. There are 3 points we're going to consider. It's on the outline. Number one, magnifying a divinely appointed leader, Joshua at Jordan. Joshua at Jordan. And before I pass on to the study, may I remind you that the name Jesus is a Greek form of the word Joshua. And you will know that it was at that place of Jordan that the Lord also magnified Jesus Christ. And he said, this is my only begotten son, my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. We study about it in Joshua in the Old Testament. We study about it in Jesus and the New Testament, how the Lord magnified Joshua, and then the Lord magnified Jesus, because he has given him a name above every name, that at the mention of that name, every knee should bow. He magnified Joshua, magnified Jesus, and is magnifying all the ministers of Christ that are following after Christ. And if you continue to follow the Lord, he'll magnify your ministry in Jesus' name. Number two, the message and the ministry of Joshua at Jordan. Miracles don't just take place. Those miracles are attached to the ministry and the message. And then number three is the miracle of dividing and passing through Jordan. Let's go to number one. In number one, magnifying a divinely appointed leader, that is Joshua at Jordan. Chapter 3, reading from verse 6. And Joshua spake unto the priest, saying, take up the ark of the covenant and pass over before the people. And he took up the ark, and went before the people. And the Lord said unto Joshua, this day will I begin to magnify thee in the sight of all Israel, that they may know that as I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. And thou shalt command the priests that bear the ark of the covenant, saying, when ye are come to the brink of the water of Jordan, ye shall stand still in Jordan. Here we find the Lord talking to Joshua directly. And he said, Joshua, I have appointed you, and I'm going to testify to that appointment. I'm going to confirm that appointment. And the way I'm going to do that is that I'm going to magnify you before the people of Israel. Please understand that Joshua had promptly obeyed the Lord, and now he was to be rewarded. He had exalted the Lord, and now he was to be magnified. He had set before the people a noble example of acting by faith on the word of God. He had confidently expressed assurance that God will make his word good in the lives of the people. And now God said, those that honor me, I will honor. The people that exalt me, I will magnify. Joshua, so far, so good. You have done well. You have carried out the instruction. And I'm telling you, Joshua, I have no regret as that I've chosen you, just like he had regret that he chose Saul. But he said concerning this, Joshua, there was no regret at all. We find his confidence in God. He trusts in God. The expression of his faith and trust in the Lord, his obedience to the Lord, his devotedness to the Lord. And if we are like that, devoted to the Lord, obedient to the Lord, faithful to the word of the Lord in the little things of ministry and in the big things as well, then you will find that your obedience and devotedness to God will not be unrecognized by him. He ordained Moses at the Red Sea, and he said, Joshua, I'm going to place the same honor upon you, because here you are now, you are at River Jordan, and the situations are similar. And so I'm going to magnify you in the sight of the people. When God appoints a man or a woman to a task, and that man honors the Lord and magnifies the Lord and obeys the Lord and does what the Lord wants, such an individual the Lord will honor and the Lord will magnify to confirm his appointment of that man and that woman. That's why I'm confident that if you will continue to obey the Lord, if you continue to honor the Lord and magnify him, he's going to honor you too. is going to magnify you too. He will walk with you. He will magnify the ministry. He will magnify you because he has appointed you and you are faithful to his appointment. Now, by what took place at Jordan, Israel knew that God had actually divinely appointed this leader, Joshua. And look at what the Lord said he will do. Let's just move on to another study, which we'll come to later in Joshua chapter 4 and in verse 14. On that day, the Lord magnified Joshua in the sight of all Israel, and they feared him as they feared Moses all the days of his life. Here we're told that God had said, Joshua, I'm going to magnify you. And then we're told that he divided River Jordan. And then he was magnified in the sight of all the people. What's the result? The people believed that God had raised him up. And the people magnified him. And the people feared him. The fear we're talking about is not slavish fear. We don't have slavish fear for any leader. The fear we're talking about here is recognizing the call of God upon his life. Respecting the call of God upon his life. And going in the way of the Lord as he was directing them. We see the consequence and the result in chapter 24 of Joshua. Where it says, the Lord magnified him. They honored him. They believed him. They magnified him. They feared him. In Joshua chapter 24, verse 31. And Israel served the Lord all the days of Joshua. And that's what you want. That's all you're asking for. If all the people of God under your leadership will serve the Lord at your own time, and they will not deviate either to the left or to the right, then the Lord will have magnified you. He himself, Joshua, he kept to the watch of the Lord. And then the Lord said, because you have kept to my word, I will magnify you. There was a man to you that God promised like that and said, I will magnify you. In fact, at the beginning of his ministry, he began to magnify, and the Lord began to magnify him. Unfortunately, he did not continue in the way of the Lord for the Lord to magnify him to the very end. We're looking at 1 Chronicles, 1 Chronicles chapter 29. 1 Chronicles chapter 29 from verse 23. Then Solomon sat on the throne of the Lord as king instead in the place of David his father. And he prospered and all Israel obeyed him. That was a good time at the beginning. And all the princes in verse 24 and the mighty men and all the sons likewise of the king submitted themselves unto Solomon the king. And the Lord magnified Solomon exceedingly. The Lord magnified Solomon exceedingly in the sight of all Israel, and bestowed upon him such royal majesty as had not been on any king before him in Israel. And then we come on to chapter 1. Verse 1 of 2 Chronicles. And Solomon the son of David was strengthened in his kingdom. And the Lord his God was with him and magnified him exceedingly. You see, when the Lord loves us and he wants to prove that he has appointed us, he wants to convince the people around that the choice is not of man. That your own choice, the Lord putting you into the ministry, in the area of work you are involved in, is not an accident. It's not a mistake. The hand of the Lord is there. And the anointing, the choice of the Lord is there. He has convinced you in your own conscience. He convinces the people by exalting, magnifying you, confirming his word in your mouth. Unfortunately for Solomon, he did not continue in the way of the Lord with a perfect heart. And so the Lord could not continue to magnify him. Nehemiah chapter 13. Nehemiah chapter 13. We're looking at verse 26. Did not Solomon, king of Israel, sin by these things? Yet, among many nations, was there no king like him, who was beloved of his God. He was beloved of his God. The Lord appointed him. The Lord chose him. The Lord magnified him at the beginning of his ministry. If he had only continued in obedience to the Lord, in faithfulness to the Lord, how the Lord would have continued to magnify him. But we're told God made him king over all Israel. Nevertheless, even him did outlandish women cause to sin. As we think about that, we'll remember Samson. As we think about that, we remember David himself. As we think about that, we think about people that had great beginning, but they didn't have a glorious end. Because instead of they continuing in the way of the Lord, they didn't continue in the way of the Lord. And so what the Lord had said they will do, and what the Lord had intended to do if they had continued with the Lord could not do. He could not continue to magnify them. Let's come back to Joshua. We thank the Lord for a person like Joshua. My prayer for you is that you'll be like Joshua in Jesus' name. And it may be you have a small beginning now, but the Lord, when the hand of the Lord begins to work with you, in those little things he has committed into your hand, and you remain faithful, and you remain obedient, and you remain loyal to the word of God, and you remain, the way Joshua did, how did Joshua did in Joshua chapter 11 verse 15. If you will continue like that, the hand of the Lord will be upon you. And what the Lord has promised you, he will fulfill in Jesus' name. No matter where you are, wherever he has put you, no man shall be able to stand before you. River Jordan will part before you. He will magnify you before the people. He will impress upon the heart of the people. He is the one that has chosen you, and your ministry will be confirmed in Jesus' name. Joshua chapter 11 verse 15, as the Lord commanded Moses his servant, so did Moses command Joshua, and so did Joshua. He left nothing undone of all that the Lord commanded Moses. No wonder the Lord blessed him. The Lord magnified him. I told you about the Lord Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ, he too, he was magnified. We're now in Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3. We're reading from verse 13. You find that the Lord Jesus Christ, he was obedient to the Father. In fact, in this water baptism, he tells us a principle of his life. When John the Baptist was saying, I have need to be baptized of you, are you coming to me? He said, let it be so, so that we can fulfill all righteousness. If it is in your heart, like Jesus Christ, that you want to fulfill all righteousness in everything you do, whether you are preaching, or you are praying, or you are singing, or you are overseeing, or you are supervising, or you are counseling, you want to fulfill the righteousness of the Lord. The Lord is watching you, and as he sees even a little faithfulness, is going to reward you by confirming the word in verse 16 of chapter 3 Matthew. And Jesus, when he was baptized, he went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit descending like a dove, and lightning upon him, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And you know that Jesus, until he went to the cross, he did everything as the Lord had appointed, because he himself said, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then will you know that I have done nothing of myself, but as my Father has taught me, even so have I spoken these things. And because he was faithful to the end, being his Son, he was obedient even to the death of the cross. The Lord then exalted him, the Father magnified him, as he said unto Joshua, so he did unto Joshua of the Old Testament, and so he did unto the Jesus of the New Testament. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 9, wherefore God also has highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, of things in heaven, and of the things in earth, and of the things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The Lord did it for his only begotten Son. The Lord did it for Joshua. He did it for some time for Solomon. He did it for some time for Samson. He did it for Daniel. He will do it for you. The people God has appointed, the Lord will exalt and magnify. We go to point number 2, the message and the ministry of Joshua at Jordan. Please understand the connection between the magnifying of the Lord and the message and the ministry of Joshua, because they all go hand in hand. As Joshua was faithful to him that has appointed him, and he did everything the way the Lord wanted him to do it, then the Lord confirmed the promise he has made unto him. Joshua chapter 3, reading from verse 9. And Joshua said unto the children of Israel, come hither and hear the words of the Lord your God. And Joshua said, hereby ye shall know that the living God is among you, and that he will without fail drive out from before you the Canaanites and the Hivites and the Hittites and the Perizzites and the Girgashites and the Amorites and the Jebusites. Let's wait for a moment. Sometimes you need to understand these words we're reading so that you don't just rush on and pass over some very, very important lessons. The Lord had just told Joshua, and he said, Joshua, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to magnify you before the people. Here, Joshua, if you were in that situation, maybe if I was in that situation, then we come to the people of God, we say, you know what? Those of you that are doubting my ministry, those of you that are doubting the call of God upon my life, the Lord is going to do something to show you I am not an ordinary leader. The Lord is going to magnify me. No, Joshua was meek. Joshua was humble. He will not speak about himself. He will not speak about the Lord exalting him, magnifying him. All he was concerned about was the glory of God. Leave all that alone. The Lord said he will magnify you. Yes, he will. The Lord said he will exalt you. Yes, he will. The Lord said he will confirm your ministry. Yes, he will. Don't blow your trumpet. Don't talk about it. You go and preach the gospel and preach Christ and exalt the Lord. Hear what Joshua said. Joshua said, come hither. Hear the words of the Lord your God. He said, is the Lord your God. He didn't even personalize it that you may know. I know the Lord so much. I'm close to the Lord, intimate with the Lord now. Hear the words of the Lord my God. No, he was concerned for the nation of Israel. And then he said, the Lord is going to do this. He didn't say the Lord is going to do it that he might confirm my ministry. The Lord is going to do it so that you will know that the Lord is among you. And you will know from this initial miracle that he will continue other miracles and he will drive out the Canaanites and the Hivites. He mentions a lot of them. What do we know about these nations that the Lord said he will drive out from before them? Look at Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 1. Deuteronomy 7, verse 1. When the Lord thy God shall bring thee into the land whither thou goest to possess it, and has cast out many nations from before thee. Listen, is the same list. The Hittites and the Girgashites and the Amorites and the Canaanites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. This is very important now. Seven nations mightier and greater than thou. Those were the nations the Lord said he was going to drive out from among them, from before them. And he chose you then. When God has appointed you, and he has, he will drive out the enemies of the people of God that are stronger than the people of God. He will use you to defeat all those enemies in Jesus' name. And so you find here that Joshua's message was that of faith and that of implicit obedience to the word of God. Please understand, ministry and message are linked together. You cannot separate ministry and message. They go hand in hand. If the message is God honoring, then the ministry will be God honoring. If the message is faith building, then the ministry will be faith building. And Joshua spoke with confidence because he had unswerving faith, unswerving confidence and trust in his heart. Doesn't the Bible say from the lips of Jesus, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh? And so he was committed to the word of the Lord, and the God of the word was committed unto him too. Now, do you see the title he gave to the Lord? Look at it in verse 10. Joshua said, hereby shall ye know that the living God is among you. The living God. What does he mean by that? It's drawing a contrast. He's saying, oh yes, naturally, physically, looking at it by sight, it appears that these seven nations are stronger and mightier than thou. But understand, with them is the arm of flesh. In fact, the idols they are serving, the gods they are serving, are dead gods. But you are serving a living God, and one with God is in the majority. If God is with us, who can be against us? Look at that comparison or contrast in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9. For they themselves show for us what manner of entering in we had unto you. How ye turned, listen to this, how ye turned to God from idols, dead idols, to serve the living and the true God. That's what Joshua was telling them. He was telling them in the message he gave to them. He said, all those idols, they are just dead idols, and they are dead gods, and they are nothing. But you will know hereby, well, you know, that the living God is among you. Try to compare and contrast in your own mind. And the contrast is that the gods of the Canaanites were dead, but the God of the children of Israel and our God is the living God. Our God is alive. Those gods, they are nothing. Our God is almighty. Those idols, they are powerless. Our God is omnipotent. Those idols, they are dead and dumb and blind. Our God is all-seeing. Our God is omniscient God. That is, he knows all things. He sees all things. And then he hears the prayer of his people. You remember Elijah? When he was teasing those prophets of Baal, they were shouting from morning until the time of the evening sacrifice. And there was not anyone that regarded. And there was no voice. And he said, shout more. Maybe he went on a journey. He knew they was having a dead God. He knew there will be no answer. And when they had cried and cried, and the dead God and the dead idols and the dumb idols and the blind idols could not do anything, he said, get aside. And then they repaired the altar of the Lord. And there was no drama. There was no gymnastics. He just came there and he brought the 12 stones and he laid the altar. He said they should put water there. And you will know that he was serving the living God. And just like the people knew when the fire fell, the fire will fall in your district. It will fall in your location. And the people, they will say, the Lord is God. The Lord is God. Then he came before the Lord and said, Lord, let all these people know that you have called me and that you have turned their hearts back again. Immediately he said that, the fire came down from heaven. This time of the revival, your district will not be an exception. As the Lord, the God of fire, as he brought the fire down at the time of Elijah, it will be so in your own case in Jesus' name. Let's come back to Joshua chapter 3 verse 10, because here Joshua now is telling us something. He says, hereby shall ye know in verse 10 that the living God is among you, and that he will without fail drive out from before you. Then he mentions them, the seven nations greater mightier than they. In verse 11, behold, the ark of the covenant of the Lord of all the earth passes over before you into Jordan. Wait a minute. He called God here by a new name. Do you realize something? Every time the Lord favors a man, he reveals unto that man an aspect of his name. He called Abraham. He revealed to Abraham something about himself, the living God. He called Moses, revealed to him, I am that I am. And now he called Joshua. Do you know that what Joshua said here about the title of God, it's never been revealed from Genesis to Deuteronomy. This is the first time such a title will be used of God in verse 11. The Lord of all the earth. And as we check up in the whole of the Bible, that title appears seven times. And we'll be studying the Bible. We know seven means perfection. It means completeness. It means that Joshua was saying, there is nothing that can contradict this one. The God we're talking about is the God of all the earth. What does that mean? It means he has universal dominion all the earth. Unlimited dominion all the earth, unparalleled authority, unequaled authority, unchallenged authority. This is a God with absolute sovereignty over the whole earth and over everyone dwelling upon the earth. He said, you will know, you children of Israel, and we too are living in this generation, we will know it in Jesus' name. That the God of all the earth, the one that has almighty power, and the one that is unlimited in his dominion, he is our God. When you think about that characteristics of God, you will throw all your doubts into the wind. There should be no doubt in your heart anymore. Because our God is with us. He will without fail, he will drive out those strong enemies before you in Jesus' name. And now comes the instruction, verse 12. Now therefore take you 12 men out of the tribes of Israel, out of every tribe a man. And it shall come to pass as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests that bear the ark of the Lord of all the earth, that's the title again, shall rest in the waters of Jordan, that the waters of Jordan shall be cut off from the waters that come down from above, and they shall stand upon an heap. Well, I just need to tell you in that area that he said it before it happened. What does the Bible say? It says, whatsoever you pray for, believe that you have received, and then you will receive. You will see it. That means you believe it, and then you will see. The people of the world will say sin is believing, but the Christian will say believing is seeing. Joshua instructed the children of Israel, and the priests and the people moved in unquestioning obedience in preparation for a breakthrough. Are you preparing for a breakthrough? I said, are you preparing for a breakthrough? It means that you are going to demonstrate unquestioning obedience. There are four things I want to just point out before we leave that area. Number one, Israel was required to act with implicit obedience in God. And so must we if we are to see formidable obstacles removed before us. Maybe you are seeing some Jordans before you now. Formidable, great obstacles before you now. He has told you already, sanctify yourself, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. And I told you, and I'm going to repeat it again, by the grace of God, as we move on, one day we're going to leave time here for testimony. And we know that the Lord is going to magnify himself in your life in Jesus' name. Two, Israel must render complete, unquestioning obedience to the Lord's revealed will. And so must we if we are to pass through and prevail and possess our possession. Number three, Israel had to fix their eyes on the Ark of the Covenant. And so must we. We must fix our eyes on Christ. Even though overflowing Jordan is before us, all those hindrances will not prevent us from entering into the promised land if we can only keep on looking on to the Lord Jesus Christ. Number four, Israel must know and view God as a God of the whole earth if they will see the miracle he will perform in their midst. And so must we. We must look on God not as a local God or even a national God, but the God of the whole earth, the God that is mighty and he has unlimited power, and in so doing will be able to conquer seven mighty enemies that may be sitting and holding on to our possession now. We're going to dislodge them. We're going to defeat them. We're going to conquer them. And we will possess our possessions in Jesus' name. We come to point number three. The miracle of dividing and passing through Jordan. The miracle of dividing and passing through Jordan. Read it from verse 14. It says, and it came to pass, when the people removed from their tents to pass over Jordan, and the priests bearing the ark of the covenant before the people, and as they that bear the ark were come unto Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water. For Jordan overfloweth all his banks all the time of the harvest. That the waters which came down from above stood and rose up upon an heap, far, very far from the city Adam, that is beside Zaretan. And those that came down toward the sea of the plain, even the salt sea, failed. And then it says they were cut off. And the people passed over right against Jericho. And then it says the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground. And in the midst of Jordan, all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people were passed clean over Jordan. Isn't that a great miracle? I said, isn't that a great miracle? You see what the Lord has done? Our God cannot fail. He did it 40 years before, and the Red Sea was divided. At this time now, he did it again. What have you heard that he did at the time of John Wesley? He will do it again. What have you heard he did at the time of Charles G. Finney? He will do it again. Have you recently heard of the ministry of T.L. Osborne? How the sick were healed, demons were cast out, and many, many people came to the Lord. What he has done in his ministry, he will use you. He will do it in your ministry in Jesus' name. Read the biographies. See what the Lord has done through the ministers that passed before you. And then, as you read all those biographies, you say, God has chosen me. The Lord chose them, and he used them in their own time. The Lord has chosen you in your own time. He will use you in the same way in Jesus' name. He did it before. He can do it again. He did it before. He will do it again. He divided the Red Sea at the time of Moses, and now the time of Joshua had come. He divided Jordan in the same way. You know what this miracle did for them? The miracle was to remove a great barrier before the people of God. Are there some barriers before the people of God today? You are the one, by the power of God, by the anointing of God, you are the one. You are going to remove those things in Jesus' name. But please, it follows the action of faith. What does that mean? River Jordan was there. It had not been divided. And Joshua said, carry the ark and keep on moving. And then as you step on Jordan, you have to, it's the action of faith. It's the act of faith. You will move forward first. You will not be walking by sight. I'll be moving forward. And yet River Jordan is still the same. It's still overflowing. Keep on moving. The moment your feet will touch that Jordan, it will be divided in Jesus' name. Not only that, it had the purpose of authenticating Israel's leader. What the Lord is doing, yes, it's because of his compassion. It's because of his mercy and love. But it's also because he wants to prove to the people around you that he has chosen you. Maybe they are saying right now, is Saul also among the prophets? Is a brother so-and-so also among, the leaders in the church? Is sister so-and-so also among the people that God has chosen and anointed? That's exactly why God is going to work those miracles through you. To confirm that it is not a mistake. You are not there by accident. He has chosen you. Let me remind you again, when they come to you for counseling, when they come to you and they have questions, don't say, oh, I wish this person will go and see the pastor maybe on Sunday or maybe on Tuesday. You are there. It was not Joshua that even carried the Ark of the Covenant. It was a priest. And as a priest that carried the Ark of the Covenant, stepped on River Jordan. River Jordan was divided. Don't walk by sight. Just close your eyes and pray. And when you finish the prayer, don't look at them. Just be looking at your God. And your God you are looking at will perform the miracle in Jesus' name. Number three, it came in recognition of the faith and obedience of the people. The Lord that says, sanctify yourself through Joshua, for the Lord tomorrow will do great wonders among you. And they did. And because of that, he honored their faith and their obedience. Tell the people that are walking along with you, tell the membership of the church, let them have faith in God. Let them demonstrate obedience in the Lord. The Lord will honor their faith and obedience. Number four, it was a great display of God's power, which brought confusion and consternation in the midst of the enemies. Do you know that when the miracle was eventually performed, it had a very terrifying effect upon the Canaanites and all the other people? Chapter 5, verse 1. Joshua chapter 5, verse 1, and it came to pass, when all the kings of the Amorites, which were on the side Jordan westward, and all the kings of the Canaanites, which were by the sea, when they heard that the Lord had dried up the waters of Jordan from before the children of Israel until they were passed over, that their hearts melted. Neither was their spirit in them anymore because of the children of Israel. Our enemies will hear of the miracle. The witches will hear of the miracle. The sorcerers will hear of the miracle. In the past, you were afraid of them. Members of the church in the districts were afraid of them. Now they will be afraid of you in Jesus' name. Now, we have talked about River Jordan. We have talked about the Red Sea. Do you know there were some differences between the miracle at the Red Sea and the miracle at River Jordan? Before we close, let me quickly tell you. Number one, we're looking at the differences now. We're looking at the contrast. Number one, that first miracle, that is dividing the Red Sea, the first miracle terminated Egypt's bondage, while the dividing of Jordan initiated their entrance into freedom and into the land of promise. That's the difference. When they were coming out of Egypt and they got to the Red Sea, when the Red Sea was divided, it terminated and ended their bondage. But they went into the wilderness after that. But now in the dividing of Jordan, it was to give them entrance into freedom and the land of promise. We had miracles before. And we had the Red Sea divided before. The miracles that are going to come now in the time of this new revival will give freedom to everybody. Will usher us into the land of promise in Jesus' name. Number two, the former miracle, that is the one at the Red Sea, was wrought for Israel to escape the Egyptians, while the latter, the dividing of the Jordan, was not to make Israel escape the Canaanites. It was to make them approach and conquer the Canaanites. We are not running away from the Egyptians now in the new revival. We are approaching the Canaanites. We are going to trample upon them. We're going to conquer them. We're going to defeat every one of them in Jesus' name. Number three, at the Red Sea, do you remember? Multitudes of Egyptians died, whereas at Jordan, not a single soul perished. This is revival of life. This is going to be a manifestation of the resurrection power of God. In the old, the miracle, the former miracle at the Red Sea, multitudes died. But this time, there will be no death. I said there will be no death. Even the enemies of the people of God, their sin will be conquered, and their will be conquered, and they will get life eternal as they repent in Jesus' name. Number four, with the exception of Joshua and Caleb, all the adults who benefited from the former miracle of passing through the Red Sea perished in the wilderness. But thank God, as we come to Jordan, all the people that passed through River Jordan, not a single one of them that had this miracle, not a single one of them died until they possessed their possession. Thank God you are alive today. I said, thank God you are alive today. A new thing is going to happen. We will all possess our possession in Jesus' name. The students and their parents, the adults and the young and the children, we're now passing through the River Jordan, and we're going to possess our possession. Number five, before the former miracle was performed, Israel was commanded, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Because the Egyptians are to see today, you will see them no more forever. At that time, they said, stand still. In this new era of the new miracle, the commandment is not to stand still. What is the commandment? Sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. Here we come tonight to the brim, to the brink of Jordan. How many of us are willing to move forward and carry the Lord Jesus Christ up? And he said, the works I do, you will do. And greater works than these shall you do, because I go to the Father. Why don't you stand up and tell the Lord, I'm ready to move forward. Although River Jordan is there in front of me, although the barriers are there before me, although the enemies, the Canaanites and the Perizzites and the Jebusites and the Ivers and the Hittites, although they are there before me, I'm ready to move forward. Lift high the ark of the covenant of the Lord. Lift high the Lord Jesus Christ. Keep on moving. Don't look back. Keep on moving. Don't look back. Let there be progress. Move in the power of the Lord. Move in the name of the Lord. Move in obedience, implicit obedience to the word of the Lord. Whatever difficulties have confronted your life in times past, River Jordan is about to dip. It's about to be parted before you. It's a new kind of miracle. It's a new kind of breakthrough that you will be able to pass through the impassable. It's revival time, and you have a part in this revival. It's revival time. You have your own share in this revival. The Lord has called you. The Lord has appointed you. Lift up Jesus and move on. Move on in obedience to the Lord, in faith in God. You will not fail. You cannot fail. The Lord is on your side. He has said he will magnify you. He will confirm his word in your mouth. Don't doubt. Don't doubt. The promises unto you and to your children, to them that are far off, as many as the Lord our God shall call. He called Moses and he has called you. He called Joshua and he has called you. He magnified those people, he will magnify you. He confirmed his word in their mouth, he'll confirm his word in your mouth. He will not fail you, he did not fail them. No man shall be able to stand before you. In this new revival, you have a part in the anointing. You have a part in the unction. You have a part in the victory. You will lead the people of God to possess their possession. You will lead the people of God to possess their possession. But keep on coming every Tuesday, that you will know the method and the way by which the Lord will make you overcome. And you are the one, a sharp instrument in the hand of the Lord, that he will use to drive the Canaanites out of the territory of the people of God, and you will lead the